resources that we can use to solve our problem. So universal sensing nodes, that's the foundation of the smart cities. Because smart city needs to be built on the data. So there needs to be intelligence. And that's come from like the sensor network. And the second thing is actually the communication, the computational infrastructure. So when you have a bunch of data spread everywhere, and how do you collect the data? And how do you store the data, process the data, so you can make the data useful? And after you have those data, you actually need to make the data open so people can actually come to use the data. If those the data is all protected, I think the usage will be very, very limited. So let me show you an example. Actually, you see like there are two companies, maybe you recognize which is this company?
Uber.
And this one is Car2Go. So both companies are not conventional transportation companies. But I would say they are smart transportation companies because they are addressing the transportation issues. But their way of addressing the issues is quite different. Right? Normally we want to see, hey, where is congested? How do we mitigate the congestion? We'll get rid of the congestion by adding capacity, by controlling people not to come to drive. But Uber way of solving the problem actually is just matching the demand and the service, right? Somebody wants to drive, somebody wants to take the ride. And what they did is just a very good structure, linking the two sides together. And this is likely to cut down the demand, likely to find the best route for those people to go to the desired places. And this Car2Go is a company also growing pretty fast. So they have the cars there just like you still drive, but you can see a bunch of Car2Go vehicles surrounding you. When you get to your destination, there are also a bunch of parking places. You can just leave the car there and the next person grabbing the ball. So both ways will significantly cut down the number of cars if they are very widely used in the cities, right? So these are actually things still transportation work for the transportation company, but it's not really started by the transportation people. And this is actually true because when I started to do traffic information research in the late 1990s, you know, the popular website in Seattle area was Washington State DOT's website, Travel Information System. But now, how many people are still using the DOT website? Myself just use Google. I use Google Map. I have it in my pocket all the time. So now there are so many interests of the IT firms and auto makers trying to work in the transportation. We need to work with them. Because if we don't, just like DOT maps, no longer popular, right? Being replaced. I think working together will likely create a win-win situation. Will benefit like both sides. But if we don't do that, we're risking losing our jobs. I think in our training, we really have some significant drawbacks in our curriculum design in the transportation system. So how do we better, like do better like than we are doing right now? So I consider all the applications like I just mentioned earlier, like Uber and the Car2Go. So these kind of applications need intelligence, and intelligence comes from the data analytics. And smart cities and the Internet of Things offer new data sources. These data sources could be very valuable to us, but they are not there that ready for us to grab. We have to do our job in order to make the data flow valuable to us. So theoretical framework and platform for data integration is a must to make a proper use of all the available data valuable to transportation. So these are all the things that we should be doing. So a lot of people are doing transportation big data analysis. To me, they are all kind of case studies. We need a kind of theoretical framework so people can say, hey, when I do the data quality control, I just need to apply these procedures. There are no such procedures. So we end up having a lot of work that's overlapped. and redundant. So what we should be doing? So I think we should be designing and deploying the sensor networks for monitoring the city's condition, purpose. And also we need to build a big data stream through properly collecting and integrating data sets. In a lot of cases, you cannot find a good answer just by looking at one set of data. Like this morning, I visited James' data collection van, and he found a lot of very interesting data sets. Like here are some cracking, here are some kind of payment problem. But if you want to explain why this happened, is this same as we predicted from the existing theory? We have to combine other data sets. For example, what is the weather in this area, right? How heavily was it utilized? Without these things, the interpretation power of that single data set will be significantly reduced. Mining data to feel the social mood, like if you get all data integrated, we process it, we can understand better of why this route is more popular than other routes. Why people try to use here, make it more congested, rather than using a different route. Supporting informed decisions by combining the future goal, current condition, and available resources. So these data actually we want to collect is because we want to make a smarter decision. We have very limited resources. We cannot do, for example, replacing all the infrastructures. But how do we make the right decision for the right piece of infrastructure? So now we have a lot of data. Over the past many, many years, we are so scared of data, and we don't have the data. And a lot of work we develop is based on imagination or assumptions of the mathematics models. Now you see we have connected vehicles going to generate way more data than we have. And this kind of autonomous driving vehicle will also have a lot of different kinds of data. Simply like a James van, I think there's the LiDAR data, there's the video data. There's the GPS data, so all these data, right, need to be combined to make the observation more meaningful. So now we have a lot of wearable equipment, like an Apple Watch, band, your shoes. These things all have a kind of signal that's potentially offering data to us. So our conventional data streams include like the traffic sensors, right? These traffic sensors are deployed periodically on the roadway network, maybe every mile, every half a mile, but they are providing the sectional observations, or maybe point observation. But now we have a lot of new data sources, like the smartphones, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, Google, Amazon search. Maybe you wonder, why is this relevant to transportation? So Baidu company in China, this is the Chinese version of Google, they actually draw Spring Festival travel package. There was 3.6 billion trips made in about a two-week period for the Chinese Spring Festival holidays. So people are normally traveling for finding where to prepare enough resources to provide the transportation needs. They did not understand how many people are going from where to where. But Baidu used people's search data, was able to give the big picture. How many people are traveling from city A to city B? I think that's very valuable information to prepare the necessary resources. And to me, I think the conventional data set, new data, adds up to be actually our transportation big data. But this big data is not just coming there waiting for us already. We have to work on it, right? So maybe you recognize these two pictures. This is the Skagit River Bridge. Collapsed 2 years ago on I-5. This is the I-35 West bridge in the Twin City area. If you have the money to fix only one bridge, which one to go first? You have to see which one is more important, right? If you're simply looking at the traffic, right? So this bridge, you have ADT lower, this one is much higher. But this one has more percentage of trucks. You know, trucks are very important for the economy, right? So, and also, if these things are dysfunctioning, are there any other ways to carry the traffic? So we have to do analysis. And this analysis cannot be just for this particular bridge. It has to be over the network. Maybe you know this bridge, actually the collapse did not affect the local area too much because there's another bridge just about several hundred feet away. So people just direct traffic to that, use that bridge. But this one was a big disaster to like the Minneapolis area. So really, we need to make our data to support this kind of decisions. So there are also other key questions, but given the time constraint, I will not go to the details. For example, how to qualify the benefit of transportation investment. So often USDOT comes to you, do you have a way that to evaluate like before and after a big investment, for example, adding one lane to a busy corridor? What's the improvement? So when the Congress gave the money to DOT and asked them, they say, oh, improve. They said, how much is the improvement? It's very hard to quantify, right? So can we quantify with the data? What's the impact of the road construction project on travel? What is the infrastructure design? Is a greener design better? Or like you build a, let's say you build a longer roadway, try to bypass a particular like a valley without doing the bridge. A bridge is expensive. But if you consider from the life cycle analysis perspective, probably having a bridge is much cleaner and much cheaper for long run. Where do pedestrians go and how to improve their safety? So a lot of the cities have the pedestrian system, but they're normally not very well connected. Which part needs to further improvement given the limited funds they have in their hands? Where to invest? This is also not clear. How to improve transit services without adding new resources? Let's say, how many people are actually using transit? How do we make the limited transit resources serve the transit users better? So before, it's very hard. You have to knock the door, give the questionnaire for people to fill up, right? But now, people use the card, like a smart card, for transit. Like in the Seattle area, they have the Opera card. In Beijing, they have the smart card, which gave you like a 60% discount. 95% people using it. It gave you very good data set about where people start their trip, where they transfer, how long they waited for transfer to which bus. So this information is great if you make use of it, try to optimize your network and operations in the transit system. Where trucks go and how to guide them to the best routes, etc. So there are a lot of things you can think about, very important for like making the decision. But previously, very hard to answer these questions. But now with the old data set and new data set jointly, we can do a lot better now. But there are still a lot of challenges. For example, exact values from like the big data, extract values from big data streams, like it is high volume, high velocity. So the big data is huge, right? So you're looking at how much data generated by like people's like self searches or cell phones, etc. And high variety and high variability. So you have a lot of social media applications, people tweeting or posting pictures. These are all data, but these data are not structured data. To process the data is very, very challenging. And there are also lack of methods and tools to take the values out. How to manage the data? Whether these data have the spatial and temporal features, and they're huge, right? How do we store and query them efficiently? And there are also the privacy issues that we have to deal with. And understanding the use of data, there are also a bunch of challenges, particularly for transportation engineers, because in our transportation theory, we are pretty much based on very small sample of data, a lot of mathematical assumptions, and also the weak data training transportation curriculum. I'm not sure about here, but when I joined the University of Washington, there's no transportation data class. So the first class I developed was transportation data management and analysis. And that has been a very popular class. And if I remember correctly, Carrie, you get your one bus away idea from that class. Okay. Right? Yeah, so I did a survey. Most universities does not have any transportation data force. But if you look at the transportation workforce challenge published by TRB, they marked data analysis scale as the top scale needed by the future transportation engineers. Are we doing our job to make the connection, right? So there seems to be a gap, and this gap needs to be addressed. And we kind of have isolated the system, isolated view, then the systematic view, because our scale, maybe you can only use Excel to do that data analysis. But the system we're developing, the DriveNet system I'm going to introduce, we have over 10,000 sensors integrated. Each sensor is generating 4,000 lines of data. We have 43 million lines of data coming from that. This is not something you can manage manually, right? You have to figure out a way to do it automatically. So anyway, relevant to these things I just presented, I think these are the emerging research areas that's going to be with a lot of potential support. So the first one, extracting transportation data from big data sources. How do you make the big data source useful for your kind of work? And transportation big data analytics. So how you can build a kind of tool or format that can make use of the data, generate useful information. And also data-driven transportation theory. So I try to call this e-science in transportation. Maybe you heard about e-science is the data-driven scientific investigation. So I would say applying that to transportation field using immense data set, I gave the term e-science transportation. Some people may call it computational transportation science. But the idea is the same. Rely more on the data than rely on the mathematical equations that are based on assumptions that we know already they're not true. So I can give you some quick examples. The first one is actually mobile sensing work we are doing at the lab. So we try to make all the electronic devices to be the data sources. You know, we have, almost everyone have a cell phone. Sometimes they have more than one cell phone, right? So when I'm traveling, I sometimes have three cell phones in my pocket. The local one, and the one I use always. Another one maybe I use for email, other things. These devices all have the network function. If they have a network function, they have a so-called media access control address. We call it a MAC address. That can serve like a unique identifier. So these devices, if you have only one, like maybe you heard about the Bluetooth-based travel time data collection, right? If you have only one Bluetooth device, you can collect the Bluetooth readings. You know how many people basically around here. If you know a certain percentage of people will have the Bluetooth in the discoverable mode, right? But if you have two sensors, one at the upstream and another at the downstream, you will know how much time people spend from the upstream to the downstream, and you can measure travel time. But if you have a reader, Bluetooth reader at every intersection, you'll be able to see how people select their routes, right? The routing becomes clear. If you have this universal, all moving, you can sense a lot more. So we build a kind of a phone app, and this phone app basically scans the surrounding signals, try to find the Bluetooth signal in the discoverable mode, and then we report the time you find this MAC address and the media access control address. We send this back to the server, and then all people send the same thing back. If you're a data observer, have the phone app installed, we can compare this and see, oh, this MAC address traveled from here to there. And then we can develop a method to try to find which route this particular person is at. This is a potential to collect pedestrian data. There's still a lot of challenges because it really depends on how long this person was observed, how frequently this person was observed. I have been with James this morning. Right? If I'm reading his cell phone, I have a certain trajectory for him. But I met, say, like a RAM only some time ago, later, maybe this afternoon I see him, see his cell phone again. Over 4 hours within the campus, you can do a bunch of things, right? This is going to be a huge uncertainty. But this is going to be a very interesting research to explore. And we have actually...
That's what? I forget to mention it to you since this classroom here, probably 1 o'clock at another classroom from coming in, so probably have 10 minutes.
Yeah, I will finish everything in 10 minutes. Okay, yeah. Yeah, so this is actually, the application actually, we developed a simulation application trying to see how this will represent the true trajectories. You see the blue circles are those actually people with the Bluetooth in the discoverable mode. And the green ones are actually the app users. And when the Bluetooth is red, it turns into purple. So after a certain time, actually, you observe all these things, you can see actually there are points observed. And then linking those points, you have an idea about where people went and so the trajectories of people. Yes, you see these are the points. Later on, you can link to the network. We found actually when you have the penetration rate to be, say, 8%, this is representing pretty well the kind of this kind of grid kind of network. So this methodology, I think, is quite feasible. So another example I want to show you is a big data example. It's called the DriveNet system. And this system actually is a web-based system for the e-science investigations. And it's real-time traffic visualization. We offer data sharing, say, we have watchdog data and maybe city Seattle's data. If one city wants it, I want to be part of this. You just upload your data following our template, and then you are part of the system. All the functions will be available for you. Washington State Department of Transportation, Department of Washington, has already decided to use this data platform to host more data to do